Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God.
Great are the works of the Lord. Glorious and majestic are his deeds. Holy and awesome is his name.
Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God.
Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ and his great mercy. He has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Christ Jesus from the dead.
Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God.
Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. Would you lift your voice?
Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God.
Amen. He's an awesome God. Defeated death, defeated sin. Alone in my sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope with no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in when death was arrested and my life began. Ash was redeemed, only beauty remains. My orphan heart was given a name. My mourning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance when death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your goodness so free washes over me. You have made me new. Now life begins with you. It's your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new. Now life begins with you. Released from my chains, I'm a prisoner no more. My shame was a ransom he faithfully bore. He canceled my debt and he called me his friend when death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your grace.
Oh, your grace so free washes over. Your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new. Now life begins with you.
Our Savior displayed on a criminal's cross. Darkness rejoiced as though heaven had lost. that then Jesus rose with our freedom in hand. That's when death was arrested and my life began.
Doesn't start when we get to heaven. Eternal life is now.
I'm now fount of every blessing. Tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing. Call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount I'm fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. I was lost in utter darkness till you came and rescued me. I was bound by all my sin when your love came and set me free. Now my soul can sing a new song. Now my heart has found a home. Now your grace is always with me. I'll never be alone. So come now, fount, come now, King. Come now, precious Prince of Peace. Hear your bride, do you sing? Come now, fount of our blessing. For thy courts above. And come now, fount, come now, King. Come now, precious Prince of Peace. Hear your bride, do you sing? Come now, fount of our blessing. Oh, come now, fount, come now, King. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it for thy courts above.
He's risen from the dead. That entitles him the right to own our hearts. Please come and reign and rule in this church, in our families, in our nation, over the universe, God. You are our reigning King. And we bow our knee before you. Thank you, Jesus, that you came and accomplished for us what we could never do on our own. In your name we pray, amen.
Amen. You may be seated. My son is exactly 392 days old. During those 392 days, he's probably had about 500 french fries. I thought my mic died there for a second. It might have. In those 392 days, he's had about 500 French fries. Don't get me wrong, right? Aubrey and I feed him a balanced diet. Aubrey's a great cook, and he loves his mama's cooking. But more than anything, with chicken nuggets as the runner-up, this boy loves some good old cut-up fried potatoes. A recent author, James Clear, said, "Your life today is essentially the sum of your habits." Throughout his short life so far, Luca has become known to me as a French fry enthusiast. There is no more giant smile on his face than when his mama comes home, where you will see all five of his cute little buck teeth, other than when you offer him a French fry. His life today reflects the habits he has made. In John chapter 6, Jesus feeds the multitudes with a miracle, multiplying a small amount of food for the second time in his ministry. He feeds more than 5,000 people until they are completely full, and he even leaves 7 baskets of leftovers, which is the Jewish holy number of completion. The people are enamored with this miracle. Right, this man can feed us whenever we need him to, they must have thought. So they followed Jesus, and they were elated to see him when they found him. But Jesus saw right through them. They weren't looking for him. They were looking for the next meal. Jesus tells them, "I am the bread of life. No one who ever comes to me will ever be hungry, and no one who believes in me will ever be thirsty again." Empty stomach or not, what Jesus said was kind of confusing. Right, so the people argue amongst themselves, how is this man supposed to give us his flesh to eat? Jesus responds rather strangely. He says, "Truly I tell you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you do not have life in yourselves. The one who eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day, because my flesh is true food and my blood is true drink. The one who eats my flesh and drinks my blood remains in me, and I in him." The people thought Jesus was rather crazy and slightly cannibalistic when he said this. What could he mean by eating his flesh and blood? Why would this cause them to have eternal life? Your life is essentially the sum of your habits. My son habitually eats French fries. He is a French fry eater. I habitually drink coffee every morning. I'm a coffee lover. My question for us this morning is, what are you habitually doing? Because what you habitually do makes you into the person that you are today. Jesus told this crowd of people, "Truly I tell you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you do not have life in yourselves." Why? Because Jesus is life. He is love. He is a love that is more powerful than death. If they don't eat him, then they won't have life in them. Jesus is offering us the opportunity to become like him. If we want to have eternal life, if we want to be raised from the dead, if we want to have life with the Father, if we want to have peace on earth as it is in heaven, then we have to get habitually abiding in him. So as Jesus told his disciples to do, this is the time of service where we do exactly that. We drink this cup of juice and we eat this cracker habitually every week. Symbolically, we eat the flesh and the blood of Christ because we choose to let the sum of our habits look like Christ, because we want to be like him. We want life. We want to be known as resurrection people. We want to be known as Christians. So Heavenly Father, thank you. Thank you for this moment where we get to abide in you. God, thank you for this habit that we create and give space for every week. God, we are the sum of our habits. God, let us habitually abide in you. It's in your Son's name that we pray. Amen.
Father, thank you that you have indeed done all that was required to bring us to yourself. Thank you that we get to celebrate the resurrection, not just on Easter and not just the week after Easter, but every single day. And we get to live within its implications every single day as well. God, guide us now in our time together as we open your word and study it and learn what it might mean for us to grow by going. Thank you for Jesus, for the opportunity to be here this morning. And it's in his name that we pray. Amen. I am this morning going to break the primary rule of communication 101. Okay? So bear with me for just a moment. But not 2 minutes ago, I spilled tea on my pants. You may or may not have been able to see that prior to me identifying it for you, but I know for a fact that if I was to stand up here this morning and pretend that it didn't happen, whether or not you noticed it, I would know that it happened, and I would be wondering whether or not you noticed. And it would throw the whole thing off. And so I, this morning, just wanted to make sure that we start off on the same page, right, by acknowledging the fact that Shane is a klutz, and he spilled tea on his pants right before sermon. This is the worst nightmare scenario for me, friends. Here's the good news. That was free, okay? You didn't pay for any of that, right? That is a 9:30 special for you guys, unless I do it at 11 o'clock too, and then I'll have to do this whole thing again. But for you and you alone, you get a little bit of the weird and wacky side of Shane this morning. It was January 18th of 2019. I was at the time a part-time teacher in combination with my job here. So I was a very busy person. I taught senior Bible at San Jacinto Christian Academy. I had about 20, 25 students spread over three class periods. And it was a Friday morning. So I don't work here on Fridays. My work week and our work week flows Sunday to Thursday. And so Friday morning, I just had to get up early, go teach class, and then the rest of the day was mine. It was a very busy day, a very busy day indeed. So I had taught, and I had come home, and I was going through my routine, and we were getting ready to change clothes and go about our day whenever I walked home to a really just, like, giddy wife. She's just like, hi. I'm like, hey, good morning. I haven't seen you. Like, how's your day? It's good. We should go in the bedroom. And I was like, oh, okay. So we go in the bedroom, and we're starting to lay out some clothes because we've got to pack for a trip that we're about to take. And laying on the bed is a pregnancy test and a little onesie that says newest Spurs fan. My wife, I'm a San Antonio Spurs fan. My wife told me that morning that we were pregnant with our daughter, Janessa, and it was such a special moment. It was actually our second pregnancy. We had lost one previously, and so it was just really, really special. And we sat on the bed, and we hugged each other, and we cried, and we prayed, and we laughed, and we cried some more and laughed some more. And then I remembered that we had a very busy day. Here's what else was going on that day. My mom was having surgery, so we had to go up to the hospital to see my mom and be with her in the pre-surgery stuff. And when we got to the hospital, it wasn't just my mom and my dad. It was also my sister and my grandmother and my grandfather and my uncle were all there. Remember that we had just found out that we were pregnant, and so we have this news. We haven't even got our heads around it, so now it's not the right time to tell people, and so we sit on it, and we hang out with my mom a little bit pre-surgery, and then we have to go because I told you that we're packing for a trip. The trip was our winter retreat with the youth group, right? And so we packed up, and we brought about 60 kids up to El Porvenir Christian Camp, and we were there from Friday night to Monday night with a bunch of people who we love, with this brand new bit of very exciting information. Samantha and I aren't even staying in the same cabin or the same room, and so we're not really interacting much throughout the week. So we get home Sunday night, and I say, are we pregnant? I can't remember. Was that a pipe dream, or is this a real thing? She said, no, we are, in fact, pregnant. And because of the miscarriage, we waited probably longer than we would have originally, certainly longer than we did with our first pregnancy, to tell people, even family and close friends. And so January was the discovery, but it wasn't until March that we told the world that we were pregnant and that Janessa was on the way. And it was the longest 2 months. Well, pregnancy was very long. Indeed, very stressful for me. But those 2 months of knowing and not telling very many people at all were some of the longest months of our lives. We did something similar, actually, with Corbin. This is, I'm just remembering this, too. But we found out that we were pregnant with Corbin in September. And we had an opportunity to tell Samantha's parents in person, which is really special because they live in New Hampshire. So we found out in September that we were pregnant. We didn't tell them until November, right? And when they came and visited for Christmas or for Thanksgiving. And then we didn't tell her siblings until Christmas when we were all together. So it was a long time of waiting with this brand new and exciting information. And I tell you all that to maybe ask you the question is that when you have exciting news, what do you do? What do you do with exciting news? Well, for me, you tell it, right? You share that exciting news. I remember that when we found out that we were pregnant with Janessa, I had been sitting on it for about a month and I hadn't told, but just a very, very, very few people. And I was like, I gotta tell somebody. So I was in Joplin at a conference with some school buddies, and I told a guy, I was like, nobody else knows this, so don't say anything, but you're far enough detached from the rest of my world that we're pregnant. And he got really excited, and that was fun. I had to, I don't know if you knew that, babe. Isaac Shade was one of the very first people to know about our pregnancy with our daughter, Janessa. Brand new information for Samantha this morning as well. The question this morning, friends, is what do you do with exciting news? I want to thank you guys for coming back. I'll be honest. The week after Easter is one of the like most stressful weeks because Easter week is just big and Holy Week. There's so much going on. And then Easter Sunday is just this mad, chaotic dash of like getting things done and so many people here and there and everywhere. And then you're exhausted and then you get hit with the exhaustion on Sunday afternoon going into Monday. And about Wednesday, you begin to wonder, like, is anybody coming back? So thank you guys this morning for coming back and being with us again. We're in the third iteration of this series that we've been in for a majority of the year together. This phase of the series is called Going, right? What I've come to kind of learn and discover is that it's really an extension of the Growing series that we started off with. We grew 3 weeks in Growing, remember, and then 3 weeks of Giving, and now we'll spend 3 weeks in Going. And what I've learned as I've been thinking about these things is that it really all falls under the umbrella of growing. This is how Christians grow. And so the question that I want us to engage this morning is, what do you do with exciting news? Last week was Easter. We got and were reminded of the best news that this world has ever received, that the King who was promised, Jesus, did what we couldn't do, navigated the life that we couldn't navigate, lived the perfect life, and died. But 3 days later, resurrection morning, he walked out of the grave, and that walking out of the grave changed everything, not just for him and the people that were closely associated with him at the time. It changed everything for everyone, everywhere, forever. What do you do with exciting news? There's 4 different accounts in our Bibles of the ways in which people engaged with that news. And there's different reactions and different responses. The Response in Mark has always really haunted me. Mark chapter 16, it says that they were the women came to the tomb to prepare the body and to interact with it, to prepare it with some spices. It says, then looking up, they saw that the stone had been rolled away, and it was very large. And entering the tomb, they saw a young man sitting on the right side. He was dressed in a white robe, and they were alarmed. He said to them, "Don't be alarmed. You seek out Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He is risen. He's not here. See, here's where they laid him. Go and tell his disciples and Peter that he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." And they went out and fled from the tomb, for trembling and astonishment seized them, and they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. The best news that the world has ever heard, and the first people to hear it, said nothing, for they were very afraid. That haunts me. I don't know what to do with it. Jesus continues this series of appearances, and we know that he spent about 40 days with them after his resurrection, teaching the disciples. Remember that he brings Peter back into the circle and reestablishes him after he is betrayed. And then one day they're walking along and at the Mount of Olives, which is a very important spot for Jesus and his ministry. And he says, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them everything that I have proclaimed to you. And behold, I will be with you until the very end of the age." And he said that, "I will be with you until the very end of the age." And he ascends into the clouds. And the disciples don't quite know what to do with that. Acts tells us that they just kind of stand there looking into the clouds as Jesus disappears. And they go back into this place that they've kind of established as a base camp. And they spend about 10 days there. And on the 10th day, which happens to be the day of Pentecost, which is a very important celebration in the Jewish world, the Holy Spirit descends on them, and they go from hiding to proclaiming the work of Jesus in a matter of moments. There's this massive change that happens. They start out scared and hidden, but it doesn't take long for the Holy Spirit to take hold of them, and in doing so, their mindset, their attitude, their approach totally changes into something totally and completely new and different. What do you do with the best news that you've ever heard? I was a freshman in Acts class at Ozark Christian College, and the first collegiate assignment that I ever completed was to outline cases of salvation and of evangelism in the book of Acts, right? It's the story of how the church grew and the Holy Spirit came and people went. I brought that assignment for you today. If I was to look at it again now, I understand that it would be more thorough than 18-year-old Shane in his very first collegiate assignment in 2008 would have been, but nonetheless, I think it conveys the point that I'm trying to make this morning. Salvation and evangelism in the early church. Peter speaks to a crowd in Jerusalem on the day of Pentecost, and about 3,000 were added to their number that day, Acts 2:41. Through the works of the church, the Lord added to their number daily, Acts 2:47. After Peter and John speak before the Sanhedrin, the number grew to about 5,000, Acts 4:4. More and more people believed in the Lord and were added to their number, Acts 5:14. After the choosing of the 7, the word of God spread even more, and the number of disciples in Jerusalem rapidly increased, and many priests came to the faith, Acts 6:7. All those living in Lydda and Sharon saw Paul and came to the Lord, Acts 9:35. Peter raises Tabitha from the dead, and many people believe, Acts 9:42. The men of the churches of Cyrus and Cyrene go to Antioch and to Greece and to bring many people to the Lord, Acts 11:21. Barnabas goes to Antioch where he was filled with the Holy Spirit, and a great number were brought to faith, Acts 11:24. Those are just the cases of large groups of people converting to Jesus in the early years. Salvation of individuals or small groups of people. Philip is led by the Holy Spirit to the Ethiopian eunuch whom he tells the good news to and baptizes, Acts 9:26 through 39. Saul is converted by Christ on his way to Damascus, Acts 9:1 through 31. Peter visits the home of Cornelius and tells him and his family the gospel, after which they believe, and the whole family is baptized, Acts 10:34 through 48. After Paul strikes Elymas blind, the proconsul believes because they are amazed at his teaching, Acts 13:4 through 12. An angel appears to Paul and Silas while they are in prison and frees them, but they stay there in the prison and prevent the guard from killing himself, and they bring him and his family to Christ, Acts 16:16 to 34. Paul addresses the council of Athens and Dionysius and Damaris along with the few others believe and follow him, Acts 16 to 34. Evidence and indications and events of mass evangelism in the book of Acts. Peter heals a crippled beggar, then shows the crowd in Jerusalem that all that they have believed before has led up to the coming of Christ, whom they first denied. He tells them how to lay their lives down and come to Christ, Acts 3:13 through 26. Apostles were filled with great power from the Holy Spirit and continued to testify to the resurrection of Jesus, Acts 4:33. After being persecuted for their actions, the apostles continued day after day to never stop teaching in the temple courts, proclaiming the good news that Jesus was the Christ, Acts 5:42. Philip is followed by a large crowd who had once followed Simon the sorcerer. The crowd began to believe Philip as he preached, and many were baptized, 8:12 of Acts. As soon as Saul and Barnabas arrived in Salamis, they proclaimed the word of the Lord in the Jewish synagogues, Acts 13:5. Paul and Barnabas remain in Antioch where they have taught and preached the word of the Lord, Acts 15:35. When Paul addresses the Ephesian elders before his departure, he makes sure that it is known that he has not hesitated to preach anything that would be helpful to them in coming to the Lord, going both from house to house and speaking publicly. He declared the word both to Jews and Greeks, Acts 20:20 through 21. Evangelism through miraculous signs and wonders. Peter and John heal a crippled beggar at the temple gate, Acts 3:1 through 10. The apostles perform many miraculous signs and wonders among the people, although no one else there joined them, even though they were highly regarded by the people, Acts 5:12 through 13. And Philip visits Samaria and does many signs and wonders, causing the people to pay attention to what he said. He caused great joy in that city because he threw out many evil spirits and healed many paralytics and crippled. What do you do when you hear, see, experience the best news that you have ever heard? Well, Acts would tell us that you go. Acts would tell us that you tell everyone that you know, and lots and lots and lots of people that you don't know, what you have seen and heard and experienced. The last things that Jesus ever told to his disciples was to go and to make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that he commanded them. Same year as this assignment, I was a freshman in Acts. Excuse me, not in Acts class, in a class called Personal Evangelism. It was a junior level class. I didn't know that when I signed up for it. Wish I wouldn't have. 7 o'clock in the morning. My professor is Terry Boland, who is just this giant human being, right? Just this huge man. And I'm not exaggerating. He was an Olympic gold medalist in the senior adult Olympic Games, right? This is just a huge, in powerlifting, by the way, not like ping pong or something like that, right? Powerlifting, all right, friends? Like, this is a huge man. The voice of God, right? Just this deep, deep voice, and he walks in that 7 o'clock first day of class. This is true freshman Shane Wiley in his very first class, not knowing that it was a junior level class. And he says, Jesus' final command to his disciples was to go and to make disciples of all nations, baptizing them and teaching them. My question this morning for you is, what is the imperative command of the Great Commission? I've never heard those words before in my life. I don't know what you're talking about. What is the Great Commission? What is an imperative command? What are we talking about? Why am I sitting in a school room class at 7 o'clock in the morning? Same question, friends. The imperative command, in case we're rusty on our grammar, is the action point, right? It's the verb. It's the thing that you are supposed to do. Jesus' Great Commission. Go make disciples, baptize, teach are the four verbs that we find in there, but only one of them is imperative. It's the only one that is like the thrust of the sentence. Would you like to, this morning, level a guess? It's 10 o'clock, so you guys should be wide awake. Go make disciples, teaching and baptizing. What is it? That's what I said too. Go is what I said too. Make disciples. Make disciples. The Greek structure there is actually a little bit interesting, and it's not a bad translation to say go, but it's more of as you are going, right? As you are going throughout your life to the grocery store, to the gas station, to your job, as you are going, make disciples. In everything that you do, make disciples. The imperative command of Jesus' final teaching to his disciples is make disciples. If you don't hear anything else that I tell you the rest of the morning, hear this, three simple words. Disciples, make disciples. You may be thinking to yourself, I don't know how to do that. Isn't that your job, Shane? Just get them here and you can figure it out from there, you can sort them out. No, it's not. Any more than it's yours. Disciples make disciples. And friends, we have the best news ever. Jesus, the Son of God, was dead, and now he's not. I was dead, and now I'm not. Last Friday, I went to Coulter Gardens because I'm trying to be a gardener. Not even like fruits and vegetables and that kind of stuff. I don't have time, space, energy for that. I just have flower beds that in 2 years of living at our house, we've never done anything with. It's time to do something with these flower beds. So I go to Coulter Gardens and I'm like, I have yard problems. And I told them about my yard problems, and they told me what to do. And I said, I have flower bed problems. And they said, you're going to want to talk to Warren. You guys are laughing. Y'all know Warren? That guy's awesome. They said, well, he's not here right now, but you can come back and you can talk to Warren. I said, okay. So I came back whenever they told me to, and I was like, I'm here to talk to a guy about flower beds. I forgot his name. And they're like, oh, you're going to want to talk to Warren. I was like, okay, cool, where is he? And they were like, oh, he's in his office. I was like, okay, great. Like, well, he owns the place. I was like, okay. You could just go back there. I was like, oh, okay. So I go back there. I almost fell off the stage. I just go back there. And we'd knock on his door. He's sitting there at his computer. And I was like, hey, Warren, I hear you're the guy to talk to about flower beds. And he like cleared his desk off and like got this piece of paper. He's like, what do you got? What do you got? What do you got? And I was like, well, here's some pictures of like what I'm working with. What direction does the house face? It's east-facing house. Okay. And he drew my house, right? The outline of the front of my house with the driveway and it curves. And he was like, okay, so you're going to want to do this. He spent 20 minutes and from memory created me this entire plan of how exactly to go about like tilling up the ground and composting and putting all of these flowers here. And you're going to want to put these blooms here and these blooms here. And these are going to bloom in the spring and these in the summer and these in the fall and these in the winter. So you have color all year round. 20 minutes and my brain is just melting out of my eyeballs because I have no idea what he's talking about. And he's not like looking it up and researching. He's doing this all from his memory, right? I left. I was like, Samantha, we have bitten off more than we can chew. But I was so impressed with Warren and my experience with him on Good Friday that between Good Friday and today, not counting you guys, I told no less than 7 people, you got to go see Warren at Coulter Gardens. The guy's crazy. Incredible. Like if you have any flower, I told my next door neighbor, I told my down the street neighbor, I told my grandma, I told my mom, I told Jake, I've told other people, I can't even remember now how many people I've told about my experience with the owner of Coulter Gardens. Would you like to know this week how many people, not counting you guys, I have told about Jesus? 0. 0. Now, I've taught some classes and I've done some Bible studies and I've interacted with some folks here, a lot of you guys in the room, but I don't count you, no offense, but you guys know what you're talking about, right? You know about this Jesus person. I'm talking about people who didn't know about Warren before. These are the folks that I've told about Warren. And people that didn't know about Jesus before, don't have a relationship with him, or at least it's not a relationship that I can tell, like these people have spent time with Jesus. 0. And yet, disciples make disciples. That is the thing that we have been called, tasked, and empowered by the Holy Spirit to do. Here's what I wonder, is that if we do emulate the disciples in the book of Acts, but not from this sheet of paper that I've just probably boringly read off to you. Like, we don't do that great, but here's what we do whenever they were standing on the Mount of Olives. Jesus said to them, you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. Fun fact, that's the outline of the book of Acts. You can literally trace the disciples and the church's progression and growth from Judea, from Jerusalem 1 through 8 to Judea and Samaria 8 through 15 and to the ends of the earth, Paul taking it all over the globe from 15 through 26. It's an outline of the book of Acts. You will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. And when he had said these things, as they were looking on, he was lifted up and a cloud took him out of their sight. And here's where we copy the disciples. And while they were gazing into heaven as he went, behold, 2 men stood by them in white robes and said, men of Galilee, why do you stand looking into heaven? Don't you know that the Son of Man, he's going to come back in the same way that he just ascended? But in the meantime, he has given you a job to do. Why do you stand around looking into heaven? What are you focusing on? And I'm afraid that we have these really great heart of, man, I want to just see Jesus, just more Jesus, more Jesus, more Jesus. And you're not wrong. We're not wrong for that approach. But sometimes we get so lost in like the staring off into heaven that we forget that we have a job here to do. And our job, friends, isn't just, if I may be honest, to like go out there and like live a good life. And hopefully that good life will like make somebody ask a question, and then we can just say, why don't you come to church with me? Don't hear me. What I'm not saying is like, I hope that you bring your friends with you to church. But I hope that you don't use bringing your friend to church as a cop-out for doing your job of discipling them, because disciples make disciples. You know your friends and your family and your coworkers better than I do. And so I am thrilled to have the opportunity to stand up here every single week or every couple of weeks and remind people of who Jesus is and what he has done for them. But I don't have the time or the space in my calendar to disciple your people, because I'm trying to be better about discipling my own. But you do. And you have everything that you need to make disciples. It's not because you're incredibly wise or incredibly brilliant or incredibly well-versed in the scriptures, although you guys are those things. I've interacted with enough of you to know. You guys know your stuff. It's because you have the Holy Spirit living within you. I am with you always to the very ends of the age, the last thing that Jesus ever said. And I wonder if sometimes whenever we think about discipleship, if we mix it up a little bit and we forget what the point of discipleship is, because the point of discipleship is to make people, help people, guide people, partner with people to look more like Jesus. Not to look more like me or look more like you, or it's to look more like Jesus. And so long as you are following Jesus and through the power of the Holy Spirit living in you, doing your best to emulate the things that he did, to believe the things that he said and taught and live the way that he lived, you can disciple. Because it's not, hey, come follow me. It's, hey, come follow me as I follow Christ. The goal of discipleship is not to make a bunch of little yous, it's to make a bunch of little Christs. It's what Christian means, by the way, you know that, right? In the book of Acts, it was developed as a derogatory term for people who followed Jesus. People called them Christians. Look at these little Christs over here. They were like, oh, we like that, thank you. Before that, they were just called followers of the way. The way of Jesus, the things that Jesus put into place and into practice. We're just going to try as best as we can to follow that and invite people alongside us as well. You don't have to have this all figured out. You don't have to be very far down the road yourself at all. All you have to do is to invite people on the journey with you. Because disciples make disciples. So my challenge for you this morning is find somebody, you know who they are, probably thinking about them already. Invite them on the journey with you. You can be open and vulnerable as you want. It's like, hey, I don't have all this figured out, but I'd love to walk alongside you as We figure it out together. Maybe there's some of us in the room who this is all strange. Like, I don't know what you're talking about. That's okay. I'd love to talk to you more about what I'm talking about, help you understand who this Jesus guy is a little bit better and why he's worth following. Maybe you are, you've been doing this Jesus thing a while, but you've found yourself kind of floundering a little bit and you're not sure what to do and nobody's really taken the time to disciple you. I'd love to talk to you and to help you figure out how that might look differently and better for you. I'd love to work with you to find somebody who that we can match you up with to come along this journey of disciple making together. Because friends, when you have the best news that has ever happened to anybody, anywhere, at any time, you tell it. Father, would you help us to be bold and to be brave in going, and as we are going, to make disciples. Give us eyes to see people who are different than us. Give us, maybe more importantly, a heart that breaks for those people who we know aren't being shaped by you. Would you, in our own lives, highlight for us ways in which we have fallen short of following you, so that we could work together, maybe even with the community of people here at Washington Avenue, to bolster ourselves in those weak spots so that we may be a better disciple of you, so that we could be more equipped and better able to go and make disciples, because that's what we want to do as your disciples. We want to follow your commands. We want to follow all of your commands. And sometimes maybe the command that we miss most is your last one, to ourselves make disciples. Thank you for Jesus, that he is the best thing that has ever happened to us. He is the best news that we've ever heard, that he walked out of the grave. It is in his name that we pray. Amen. Friends, welcome to Washington Avenue Christian Church, where real people find real grace for real growth. We are really, really glad that you are here with us this morning, whether you've been coming for decades or whether you've been coming for weeks, or maybe it's your first time. We are so thrilled that you're here. My name's Shane. I get to be one of the pastors here. If this is one of your first times here and you haven't already done so, would you grab a Connect card out of the pew in front of you? They're the long rectangle ones, look like what's on the screen behind me here. Give us some information there just so that I can follow up with you this week, say hi, get to know you just a little bit better. This is also a great place if your information has changed, whether it's a mailing address or maybe an email address, you feel like you're missing out on communication here. It might be because we don't have your email, or it might be because we have the wrong email. So if you would just update that, if you feel like you're not getting information, I will personally make sure that I get that filled out, or not filled out, but updated for you on our online database. Yesterday, we had a great morning at our Ironman men's breakfast. It was our last one for this year before our Ironman men's retreat, which is coming up at the end of April. You do still have time to register for that event, men. You have until next Monday to register for that event, or maybe it's Tuesday, but right around that time. It's at El Porvenir Christian Camp, which is one of my favorite places in the whole world. This will be our first time back there since 2019, between COVID and fires and those things. So we're really, really excited to go back there again this year, and we hope that you'll join us. If you have more questions about that, you can grab myself or Lenny, or you can go right over here to the information desk, where we'll have people there to answer your questions. Any other things that you might have questions or concerns about, the information desk is a great place to get that information. Also, our website is chock full of all kinds of information and events and things going on, so I'll direct your attention there. We are so glad that you are here with us this morning. remember this, that you are the light of the world, so let your light shine before others that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. That's Matthew chapter 5, verse 14 to 16, and it's something great for us to keep in our hearts and our heads as we go forth this week. So we love you guys. We will have some elders up here who are praying, and will be praying with their spouses. If you find yourself in need of prayer or if you have anything that you want to talk about, we would love to meet you here at the front. Thank you for being here this morning. Have a great week.